أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد النبي العربي الأمي الأمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. This is the night of Friday. And alhamdulillah, we intend to talk about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam lifetime, especially when it comes to the night of, the end of Thursday, which is the night of Friday, because we are trying to say as-salatu wassalamu ala rasulillah as much as we can, because it has a lot of rewards, specifically during the day of Jumu'ah or the night of Jumu'ah. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik ala nabiyyina Muhammadin. In our journey with Sirat al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have reached to the point of al-wahy, the revelation, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was at the cave of Hira, and the angel Jibril descend to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with the very first verses in Surah Al-Alaq, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Iqra' bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq, khalaqal insana min 'alaq, Iqra' wa rabbuka al-akram, alladhi 'allama bil qalam, 'allama al-insana ma lam ya'lam. Alhamdulillah, if you are from those people who were joining us from the beginning, alhamdulillah, we started from the very beginning, even before the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We started at a time of when his grandfather, Abdul Muttalib, was trying, you know, to supplicate to God to give him 10 kids. And then, you know, the rest of the story. I don't like you to, you know, to be feeling any kind of boring or so. And we went all the way till we reached to the point of Al-Wahy. Let's continue from this point. And inshallah, if you are interested, and I believe you are, please get back to the Masjid Facebook page and also YouTube channel of the Masjid. It has all the lectures, inshallah, from the beginning, and you could, you know, go with one by one to picture in mind the seerah and the lifetime of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam from the beginning all the way to what we are talking about today, which is right after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam got the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik ala nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. So we mentioned that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam received the first revelation through the angel who? Jibreel, right? The angel Jibreel alayhi salam, the archangel, was in charge of delivering all the messages and all the revelations through to all the prophets, not just the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because as you know, the core and the essence of all of the messages is the oneness of Allah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam got the first revelation, and it was a very tough time for him. And he got back home and it started to say, Zammiluni, Zammiluni. And he was talking to Sayyida Khadija, his wife, may Allah be pleased with her. And he was saying that I had that fear. He had a fear because, you know, meeting the angel Jibreel in person and having this, you know, conversation with him is not easy. And even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he talks about the revelation of Quran, he says in Surah Al-Muzzammil, Inna sanulqi alayka qawlan thaqeela. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was almost, you know, sweating all the way every time he gets the revelation from Allah. It was a very tough time for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam because the message is something huge. It's not easy. And inshallah, let's go from this point. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam got the commandment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to start da'wah, to let some people know, but in secret. So the first stage of da'wah, after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam got the revelation from Allah, Allah subhanahu amarahu Allah ta'ala an yad'uwa ila al-islami sirran. Limadha? عليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. بارك الله. Have a seat. جزاك الله خير. Actually, he's leaving. Okay. He was saying goodbye. أمره الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يدعو إلى الإسلام سرا. لماذا؟ Why is it that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was ordered to deliver the message of Islam in secret at the beginning? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most wise. We have so many lessons to extract from this stage and from this point. First off, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at the beginning, the deen, the Islam itself was weak. He was not surrounded by a lot of people so they could support him. So it was at the beginning. And the most important thing we could understand from this is to utilize the means, al-akhdh bil-asbab. Otherwise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah could have just, demolished everything, the idols and the people and even the mountains, right? It does not take time. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most capable of everything. Yet He commanded the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to go through this process. To let us know that this life is a big test, is a big ibtila. That sometimes you are in a hardship, sometimes you are in ease, sometimes you are suffering any kind of troubles, and sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and in all times actually, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala gives you rewards. Whether you are grateful, shakiran, when you have a blessings from Allah, or sabiran, when you are in a hardship. And this is actually the attributes of mu'min, right? عجبا لأمر المؤمن كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إن أمره كله له خير إن أصابته سراء شكر فكان خيرا له وإن أصابته ضراء صبر فكان خيرا له. So the believer is always between two status, one of two, whether he is grateful when he is in ease or he is patient when he is in hardship. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم started to deliver the message in secret. In secret here means that he was just telling some of his closest companions, his closest friends, his closest beloved people. Of course, as Sayyida Khadija radiallahu anha, and she was the first amongst women to believe in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And his closest friend, his closest companion, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, also was the first to believe in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam from amongst men. Ali ibn Abi Talib, Zayd ibn Harith, and so on. He started just with the people who really trust them. And every one of them also started like to make da'wah and to deliver the message, let's say to his family, to the people that he is trusting. They are trying to do this in hide. Otherwise, they will be exposed to the chasing of the disbelievers. And at that point, the disbelievers having everything, the authority, the money, the army, the power, everything. If they just say, we are so strong, we will, stand in front of the wave, this is not wise. This gives us a lesson that to be wise in every step you take in this life. Because it's not logic that someone going through a battle when he has no weapon or arm, right? So the lesson to be extracted from this huwa al-akhdh bil-asbab. So an-Nabiyyu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and actually they were gathering in a place called Dar al-Arqam, Ibn Abi al-Arqam. Dar al-Arqam is a house of al-Arqam. Al-Arqam is the owner of the house. So the house of al-Arqam. They were gathering, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he got the revelation, verses from Quran, he gathered his most closest people, his most closest companion, to let them know, to teach them how to worship Allah and what he got from Allah. And everyone takes responsibility to deliver a message in a very narrow area. Could you imagine that this stage took them 3 consecutive years? 3 consecutive years the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was practicing a secret da'wah, because they were trying to be strong before confronting the people of Quraysh, because those people were so aggressive, so tough, as we will get to know inshallah. So they spent 3 years in a row, delivering the message, talking about wahi, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam teaching them what he got from Allah through the angel Jibreel alayhi salam during these 3 years. And actually, even by the end of these 3 years, the people who believed in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was very few. But a time came, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that this is the time to make da'wah in public. And the first verse that was revealed in this topic, وَأَنذِرْ عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ, and also in Surah Al-Muddathir, قُمْ فَأَنذِرْ. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam got the commandment from Allah. And you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is supporting his Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet, once he got this revelation, he got this commandment from Allah to make da'wah in public, to make everyone and to let everyone knows about his message and he is the true messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet ascends to the mountain of As-Safa. You know, we have two mountains, As-Safa wal-Marwa. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam ascends to the mountain of As-Safa and he started to call upon people. Ya Ahla Makkah. All people of Mecca. The people started to hear the voice, and some of them say, we know, we almost recognize this voice. This is the voice of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. There should be something. And this was their way of announcing anything. You know, at that time, they weren't have like speakers and these things and microphone and that stuff. So when they want to like to announce something or to let people know about something new, they just try to ascend on the highest place in the city or in a territory where they live. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam called upon them and they went to see what Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam wants to say to them. The Prophet said it directly and he made it obvious and clear that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only God. You know, he is trying to say, and he said it, of course, that the idols you worship are nothing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only God, and I am the messenger of Allah to you and everyone and every tribe. And even he started to name every tribe by its name. What was their reaction? Before saying their reaction, could you remember when we were talking about the time when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was young and his youth, and during he was like a teenager, and so they were always calling them and referring to him as As-Sadiq Al-Amin. So you and I are expecting people to believe that man who is always on the way, never tell lies. But unfortunately, they did not believe in him. Abu Lahab was amongst the people attending that gathering. What did he say? قال ألمثل هذا جمعتنا تبا لك. طبعا تبا لك يعني دعاء بالهلك. دعاء بالهلك. وبالمناسبة كلمة هلك يعني إحنا عادة بنستعملها في موت إنسان مثلا لا نحبه أو ميتة صعبة. لكن في اللغة العربية كلمة هلك أيضا تحتمل أن تكون مات بكل بساطة. هلك بمعنى إيه؟ مات. يعني كما قيل في رثاء قيس بن عاصم وما كان قيس هلكه هلك واحد ولكنه بنيان قوم تهدم ولكنه بنيان قوم تهدم. يعني قيل في معرض المدح يعني هو الموت. لكن خلينا نرجع لنقطة تبا لك يعني هلاكا لك. هو يدعو عليه بالهلاك يعني بالموت. فأنزل الله سبحانه وتعالى قرآنا يتلى. شوف ردا على كلمة قالها أبو لهب في حق النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. فأنزل الله سبحانه وتعالى تبت يدا أبي لهب وتب. So Abu Lahab was among the people who attending that gathering, and once he got this message, of course he has something in his heart like, are you going to let us like avoid worshiping the idols and this authority and this kingdom and this money and this wealth and these properties? He's looking at it from this angle and he says, may your hand perish. This was like a phrase they were using when they tried to, you know, to supplicate against someone. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed a verse, as you all memorize in this short surah, Tabbat yada Abi Lahab wa tab. May the hand of Abi Lahab perish. And even him, all of him, not just his hand, perish. Watab. And actually, this surah specifically is one of the greatest miracles and one of the very obvious signs that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a true messenger from Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, سَيَصْلَى نَارٌ ذَاتَ لَهَبٍ. That man, Abu Lahab, will be thrown into the hellfire anyway, definitely. Allah decided this. If you are in a situation that someone is trying to threaten you or like to, you know, to attack you, and he says, if you are able to do this, I will leave you. I will do that, like to move this from here to there without having any intention, without having any, you know, feeling. Abu Lahab could have just said, okay, you say that Quran is true and Muhammad is a messenger, and your God, Allah, saying that I will be in the hellfire if I do not believe in Muhammad. Okay, I believe in Muhammad. He could have just said it without feeling, without having the true faith. He could have just said, La ilaha illallah, even Muhammadur Rasulullah, without having the true faith. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala controls the hearts, controls the tongues. And everyone has a bit of mind and intellectuality. He could just understand that this is a great sign. Abu Lahab spent so many years after this revelation, but he has never uttered or even pronounced a word that have a meaning of faith or belief. Even he wasn't even able to mock the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or to make fun of him against Quran. So سَيَصْلَى نَارًا ذَاتَ لَهَبٍ. Okay, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this verse, تَبَّتْ يَدَ أَبِي لَهَبٍ وَتَبْ. Of course, as you are expecting, once the disbelievers got to know that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is calling to a new religion, is calling to the only one God, who is Allah, and he's saying that he is the prophet and the messenger of Allah, and he was famous for his good words and his ethics and his morals sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they were expecting people to follow him. They started to chase everyone trying to join Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they were blocking every way to get to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because if someone met with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he will end up, you know, definitely will end up believing in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a messenger. A lot of people who joined the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam got tortured, like Bilal ibn Rabah, Ammar ibn Yasir. You know, Bilal ibn Rabah, he has like a famous word. The more they torture him, the more they put him through a punishment, عذاب, the more he says, أحدٌ أحد. I believe in one God. I believe in Allah. He is like saying, I know that Allah will save me. So everyone believed and followed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at this stage specifically. They got tortured in every way possible by the disbelievers of Mecca, and the days went on, and to the point that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the people who believed in him and who followed them, they had to migrate to Al-Habasha, and this will be inshallah our starting point next week. So they have two migration. They migrated to Al-Habasha twice, even before, you know, the huge migration, you know, from Mecca to Al-Madinah. There were also two times migration to Al-Habasha because of the punishment and because of the, you know, chasing and killing and torturing that they got and suffered from the disbelievers. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us all follow the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and to give us the lessons and the understanding and the absorbing of the Prophet's lifetime, and to make us amongst الذاكرين الشاكرين الحامدين. اللهم آمين. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم، وأكثروا من الصلاة والسلام على حبيبنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم في ليلة الجمعة، ونراكم بإذن الله تعالى في الصباح. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.